With all the crews in Miami, it's time to relax and enjoy some of the attractions of sunny Florida. There's a disastrous start to leg six by two-thirds of the fleet.
Everybody but Assa, Abloy, and the girls are over early.
Run her off! Run her off!
Then it's an incredibly close match racing sprint up America's eastern seaboard to Baltimore. Previously on the Volvo Ocean Race, the fleet sailed 4,450 miles from Rio de Janeiro up the east coast of South America, across the equator, and through the doldrums to sunny Miami. There was more trouble for Team SEV when they managed to collide with Ilbrook in broad daylight.
Not quite sure exactly what went on, but they hit us.
And the incredibly close racing meant the pack leaders were within sight of each other for nearly all of the leg.
Still got our mates, Assa Abloy out there, who we've seen every day bar one since leaving Rio.
However, fickle conditions near the finish line meant favourites Ilbrook were pipped at the post by Assa Abloy, who gained her second victory of the race so far.
Oh, absolutely fantastic. It win any legs, brilliant, but to get another one in is really, really good. I think we can knock a few more off, hopefully.
An exhausted crew enthusiastically celebrated. But the real work will, of course, be on the legs from now on, as Assa Abloy are now the strongest contenders to Ilbrook's lead. After a rest and a haircut, skipper Neil McDonald downplayed the pressure now on them.
I don't think there's as much pressure on us as there is on Ilbrook. Everybody expects them to win every leg, and, you know, we're just one of the guys chasing them. It's a long way to go, and I think, you know, there's four or five boats just behind us who are just as equally possible of getting us as we are of getting Ilbrook.
However, the most experienced crew member has an interesting take on why the boat is succeeding.
I feel it's a different scenario when you're sailing now. You have a brain trust on board, and I don't belong to that because I don't have a big brain. So we have that, three people, and the rest of the crew is supplying a boat with good speed, good sails, good maneuvers and everything. And this brain trust has to do their job. And if they do, we win. If they don't, they are fired.
After having already travelled 27,000 miles around the world, you'd expect these yachts to be feeling the strain and showing some weaknesses. Assa Abloy claimed they needed a change to their standby yacht due to the damage they'd sustained. But it was an elaborate April Fool's joke. Indeed, apart from the major accidents like SEB losing her rig in a storm, the fleet seemed to be holding up remarkably well. Tom Fair is the operations manager for Ilbrook and has the unenviable task of keeping the yacht in perfect order throughout the race. At every stopover, the boat is taken out of the water for a complete overhaul.
I'm surprised we haven't had a lot more underwater damage. I was expecting to be repairing keels and rudders, you know, quite a lot around the world, and so far we've had very minor damage.
Most of the damage to Ilbrook has been caused by water getting into the boat.
Wait a second.
But what we're finding is you get a lot of water damage, you know, particularly after us sinking and almost closing in Cape Town. We had a huge amount of water damage. We crept right through the boat, and in Auckland we basically stripped out the whole electrical system and replaced it.
But then came the collision between Ilbrook and SEB, just out of Rio de Janeiro, which caused more than a few scratches to both yachts.
Basically, not really structural damage, it's more cosmetic. You know, it's taken a very, you know, reasonable hit, but I'm probably actually a little surprised that it's not as bad as it looks. If they'd hit slightly different, it could have been worse.
The ever unlucky Team SEB wasn't so fortunate, but accidents aside, the extreme conditions encountered in this race inevitably lead to constant wear and tear.
It's the deck hardware, I think, like the winches and the blocks. Obviously you have a lot of attrition in the ropes and sails, but that's all catered for. But actual wear and tear, it's just the moving parts on deck that seem to take at that, and I guess the ballast system.
And with 5,500 miles still to go, all the yachts must avoid complacency and be aware how easily and quickly serious damage can be inflicted. But it's not just the yachts that suffer from wear and tear. One of the more experienced sailors in the fleet, News Corp's co-skipper and campaign director Ross Field, won't be continuing in the race.
I decided after talking with Jez and talking to the other senior members of the crew that I should stand down, especially for this leg.
Ross had suffered cracked ribs and a damaged vertebrae after being thrown from the wheel in the Southern Ocean on leg two of the race, but had stubbornly battled on.
I've had five injections. I take painkillers on the boat every 3 hours, and really, at the end of this leg, still being in pain, enough was enough. And these boats are very, very physical boats, and you need 12 people who, you know, can throw all the gear over, can shuffle over to each side of the boat, and even lying in my bunk is agony, especially when I haven't taken any painkillers. I just can't punish my body anymore, and I can't carry on having injections, and I can't carry on having taking painkillers forever and ever, and it's just not good for your body.
Ross will be missed, of course. I mean, he's a huge asset to the boat, but we have to move on. He can't do the leg.
I was sort of basically running the boat at sea, and Jez was running the boat ashore, and now Jez has got to, you know, step up to the plate and run the boat while it's sailing. So yes, it definitely will put more pressure on him.
Of course, there's always pressure on my shoulders, but that's not a problem. It's what I'm here for, and you know, the whole crew are getting ready and looking forward to the next leg.
However, all that is in the future. Before then, there are 19 days of relaxation, preparation and fun to be had in Southern Florida's liveliest city, Miami. For all the crews, especially the American contingent, Miami is another popular stopover. Historically, Miami's development began following the arrival of the railroad in 1896, and boom time continued in the first few decades of the 20th century, fueled not just by the area's idyllic beachfront location and perfect weather, but also by gambling and the fact that it never really took to the idea of prohibition. Most people aren't here for Miami itself, but rather to visit Miami Beach, an entirely separate municipality famous for its beaches, clubs and bars, as well as being the site of the famous Art Deco Historic District, a collection of bright pink, lavender and turquoise buildings dating from the 1920s. The mid-80s slick cop show Miami Vice glamorized the rich life in South Florida, revitalizing the area. This led to celebrities moving in, photo shoots from all over the world being shot here, and the renovation of the Art Deco District, which has turned the city into a showpiece of fashion and trendiness. If your father is a crew member on one of the racing yachts, the only way you get to see him is if you travel round to the ports of call throughout the world. That can play havoc with your education, but thanks to Belinda Braidwood, wife of Tom, bowman on SEB, the problem has been solved.
Last race I actually went to the Auckland stopover, and I met some of the parents who were doing homeschooling, and they were having a hard time. Obviously, children feel different about their parents than they do about their teachers. So I actually came up with the idea then.
The SEB school is open to all school children whose families are travelling round with the race. As well as the usual maths and English, which are designed to fit in with correspondence courses from home, the children do projects centred on the race and the country they find themselves in.
Some of them love learning about the boats and the weather. Zach's doing his interest projects, and Zach's doing his on the weather routing of the first race. Josh did where the boats came in the first race and watching the start. Just the experiences of travelling around the world, and also the freedom to learn at their own pace and in their own way. It's a lot more open.
The Volvo Ocean Race is truly a worldwide event, covering all aspects of life and involving all kinds of people, not just sailors. The eternal city of Rome seems a million miles away from the frenetic action of ocean racing. But Rome is home to one man who is intimately connected to the yachts and their crews, although he never sets foot on a boat. Franco Costa is the official artist to the Volvo Ocean Race. But he only began painting after a career as both a musician and a theatre director.
Then I started to be a painter for sailing and trying to study. it took time because it's, of course, you have to have an idea, you have to see what you paint. And I was a little superficial in a way in the beginning.
But Franco's feeling for his subject quickly earned him a reputation as a sailing artist.
I became the official artist for Sweden. So that's why the image I made, the crossades, was very famous suddenly, became very, very well known because we printed over 5 million copies of it. Very much the nature, the purity of a sail, which is blown from the wind in a good weather, in a good sun, in a good image, I would say. So anyway, the power boats are beautiful, are very strong, are very fast, but of course they don't give me this feeling because I think the sailing is more scenic, more special, more colorful. I am working in many with many medias, but I prefer the acrylic on canvas. And then when I finish the original, we will do the graphics in a silkscreen in many, many colors.
Franco has been commissioned to paint 5 images of the race, and prints will be sold in each of the stopover ports. Franco's real skill is the way he manages to capture the raw power and beauty of man against the elements. The crews are fully aware of the raw power of nature. For many of the younger sailors involved, particularly some on Emma Sports 2, this will be an experience they'll never forget. It's unlikely the girls are going to improve on their current position, although their recent form has earned them the respect of the fleet, and they are continuing in the ever-advancing campaign for women's sailing. Unfortunately, there haven't been many opportunities to see the girls in action so far, but here are some unseen moments from previous legs. An important part of life on board is dinner time. It's something to look forward to, or to dread. Because although nutritious, the food on board is always a bit grim.
Beautiful stuff, beautiful consistency there.
Being fussy would lead to starvation. Indeed, on the Southern Ocean legs, whilst sailing hard, the crew can lose up to 11 kilos of body weight in just 3 weeks.
Just balancing on a boat, you're using up calories and energy. The body takes from the muscle and saves the fat, which is actually the reverse of what we want out here. We want it to take the fat and save the muscle so we can use the muscle in our sailing. And then, of course, we get to port and we have a few beers and eat crap food. So you get fatter and weaker as you go around the world, which is great.
Coming in late on long legs, as the girls often have, can lead to rationing. But there are always ways of making do.
Oh, it's a shocker. It's like the good, the bad and the ugly out here. We've even had toothpaste police, and if you look up there with all our toothbrushes are stacked, every morning at 4 o'clock in the morning, Emma comes around with the toothpaste, which she has in her own gear bag, and squirts a little bit on for us, because otherwise if we didn't police it, there'd be none left by now. And then you've got your one wet wipe per day, which has now been rationed probably. So you start with your face first with your one wet wipe per day. And then we've got protein bars. So we can eat a protein bar. We're halving the breakfast right now. So everything actually, the quantity sometimes stays the same, but just gets more runny. So the porridge, we do have runny porridge now, because we're halving the amount of oats. And for lunch today. We halved the lunch, so we had runny shepherd's pie and runny mashed potato. It was great. And the other day, I put a soup sachet in my mashed potato, and made like a mashed potato soup, which was quite good. And then today I was having lunch with Anna and eating the runny mashed potato, and Anna said, what about dessert? And I said, yeah, let's have some dessert, thinking she was joking. So she pulled out these drink sachets here, which are supposed to go in our drinks. And she put it on a spoon and started licking it off like sherbet. And I thought, oh, that looks good. So I had some. And we're both licking sherbet off the spoon. And we got caught by one of the watch captains. We got the full telling off. So we were put in detention for going into stuff we shouldn't. So the more that you ration, the more you look for options to satisfy your hunger.
Rationing extends to everything on board, including those vital everyday necessities.
But then
I need a Kit Kat. I desperately need a Kit Kat.
We've got a bit of a chocolate crisis on board.
Rumour has it that there's only Lion Bars and Kit Kat, and we all know who wants a Kit Kat.
I'm willing to go 2 bars to get one.
I think it's going to be the stock market will
When does
open.
The stock market open?
It's already open. There's already one trade going on.
After her disappointment at missing out on the last leg due to illness, Bridget Suckling is now medically fit and will be back on board Amer Sports 2 for leg 6. But there's still some spare time for all the crews to enjoy the many attractions Florida has to offer. Like the Everglades National Park, which is the second largest national park in the USA after Yellowstone. And it's a mad, mad place, unless you're used to alligator-infested swamps. The whole expanse of what looks like grassland is in fact a huge slow-moving river, albeit a very shallow one, fantastically rich in both wildlife and ecosystems. The Volvo racing yachts wouldn't make much headway in these waterways, but some of their crews have found the perfect vehicle for speeding through the mangrove swamps. This airboat is perfect for getting through the Everglades without harming the wildlife.
We've had a few tough weeks at sea. It's good to relax, but it's great to get out here and have a little bit of adventure as well. Get back out to nature and see some new wildlife. I'm glad we don't have any of these crocs out around where we're sailing. Might think twice about jumping over the side.
In fact, they are alligators, and there are over a million of them in Florida. To the uninitiated, crocodiles and alligators might look alike, but there are a number of differences, not the least of which is the fact that there are fewer than 500 American crocodiles left in the US. The most obvious difference between them is that alligators have a very broad snout and a much more placid temperament, but it's best to be extremely sure before going for any quiet swims.
If you look towards the front of the boat, there's a large alligator coming this way. This alligator is probably about 5 to 6 feet long. This alligator is probably about 5 to 6 years old. Alligators grow 1 foot per year up until age 7. After age 7, their growth rate is a bit slower. Now, you guys, I suggest you keep your hands inside the boat. Alligators have about 2,500 pounds per square inch of pressure in their jaws. Their teeth are meant for crushing, unlike a crocodile's teeth, which are meant for cutting and tearing.
Oh, that's fantastic. Unbelievable. Getting out in the Everglades like this, I mean, it's a pretty different environment. Getting so close to a crocodile. One of these over there still, but I've never been that close to one before in my life. Alligator, actually. I get told off I call it a croc. Incredible.
A much more familiar and far less threatening sight for sailors are dolphins. And when the fleet are at sea, it's always a joy when dolphins come alongside the boats and seem to stick around for the company.
I mean, you're sailing along and they're jumping out of the boat to lure it, and you can see the little eyes looking at you and just saying, well, who the hell are these? What's this going on, you know? They're very inquisitive, I think, and they must just wonder what the hell we're doing out there.
Today, Emma Westmacott and Kieran Henderson from Amer Sports 2 are in Key Largo, trying to find out more about these special animals.
Definitely. These are Atlantic bottlenose dolphins here, okay? We do have 10 of them. There's 7 on this side and 3 on the other side. But the way you tell a dolphin apart is by this dorsal fin on their back. The reason why is because when dolphins come up to breathe, they always show their back. When whales come up to breathe, they always show their tail. So that's why whales are identified by their tail. So it's pretty cool. You have to put your yellow vest over it.
After having learned all the facts about these amazing mammals, the girls get the opportunity for a practical demonstration of their remarkable abilities.
Side in, girls. All right, girls, I want you to stay right where you're at and hang on to those handles. We're going to do body rubs, okay? Cosmo, you have these. Way to go, LB.
Jesus, that's huge.
Told ya. There's the middle one. Here comes the big one. Here comes the mom behind you.
Oh, my God, they're all massive.
Guys, go ahead and put those hands down to your side. Beautiful.
I'm not a big, even though I sail around the world and we're on the water the whole time, I'm not a big in-the-water person. Like, I swim, but I don't dive, and everyone's trying to get me to do dive courses, but I'm just really not into big fish and stuff. So I was a little bit scared, I think. And when they're telling you to slip in the water and there's like these three big animals sitting there, it's like, oh my God. Like, I really just have to trust the trainer that you are with and know that they know what they're doing.
They're just so friendly. I felt quite welcomed in the water by them.
Weighing in at 340 kilograms, these dolphins need to be welcoming.
When we were told to get in the water, I was just not too sure about this. But by the time, towards the end, you know, you're dragging in the water with them, it's just awesome.
I do think that as sailors, you have this affinity with dolphins, and you all get this strong bond when a dolphin comes by the bow and you see him swimming and he turns on his back and looks up at you and squeaks away, and you look down, you click at him and squeak back, and he goes off with his mates and comes back, and you'll think back and think, yeah, I swam with them.
Leg 6 of the Volvo Ocean Race will take the 8 teams less than 4 days to complete. It's going to be a titanic 875 nautical mile battle along the eastern seaboard of North America. There will be tight tactical racing from start to finish. Shorter inshore match racing legs demand as much preparation as lengthy offshore endurance ones. Every leg, regardless of distance, is worth the same number of points. And with 2/3 of the race completed and only an estimated 25 days of sailing left, every point is vital. There are various ongoing placing battles throughout the fleet, and Ilbrook's overall victory is by no means certain. With at least 2 teams snapping at their heels, there's no margin for error. So every aspect of life afloat has to be pared down to the bare necessities. On short legs, you'd expect the crews to be able to enjoy a luxurious fresh food menu, but that's just not the case.
Food for this next leg will differ a little bit from the legs before. It's shorter, so it's a little less critical on the weight. If obviously you're packing for 30 days, you put an extra pound or two in a bag, and all of a sudden you got 15 bags, and then so you got 15, maybe even 30 pounds more, and as you know, weight is so critical. A short leg, I got the luxury I can afford to put a few more little bits and pieces in to, keep the crew motivated, keep the crew energized. You know, it's nothing, nothing's worse than being on deck for 6 hours and if you're hungry. So I'm taking the opportunity of this leg to put in a little extra food. So for instance, this next leg, we normally have 2 bags of jerky, doubling up, 4 bags of jerky a day, which is good because 2 bags isn't quite enough for 12. So there's always a little tension created on board when you don't get your jerky. So I shouldn't have any problems. This leg should have plenty of jerky. Obviously, every leg weight is still important. So can't avoid it. Has to happen. You got to eat the freeze-dried. One of our favorite meals, Mexican chicken. Comes with corn chips on the side for a little crunch. We're not going to battle scurvy like our predecessors in the tall ships, but a little dried fruit, try and get the vitamins in, keep the immune system firing. Don't want to get anybody to get sick. Of course, you got to have plenty of this. Goes without saying. And then we do breakfast, do a little granola or a little oatmeal, depending upon your flavor or your poison, what you're into. About half the guys have oatmeal, about half of them have the granola. And then we got kind of tired of eating granola after a while. So we've gone to Apple Jacks. You know, you're trying everything, you try to be healthy, and you're trying to make sure that you're eating the right food. But it can get really tiring just eating the same thing all the time. So it's fun to put in every 3-4 days a little special cereal just for a surprise. And the one thing is that JK, our skipper, doesn't like the freeze-dried very much. So I put him a little personalized soup so he can have at least some food. And then, as always, to keep the fat content, because most of our meals are pretty lean, a little peanut butter that you spread on a little delicious biscuit, and just to keep the fat content up. And then, every bag is all the same. Have a menu on the outside. That way the guys know what snacks they have, they know what the meals are, and everyone knows what to look forward to or what to dread. So that's our meal for the next leg on the way to Baltimore, and I like to see you. Gotta eat to win. So obviously we've been winning, so maybe I've been feeding them well.
This is the route for leg 6. From Miami, the fleet heads north, where the southeast trade winds soon give way to more changeable weather conditions off Cape Hatteras, an area known for producing violent storms. Once the fleet enters Chesapeake Bay, the most successful yachts will be the ones that pack the best sails for the light airs, before what should be a very close sprint finish into Baltimore.
This leg's a lot about the Gulf Stream. You know, either you go in it or you don't go in it, but whatever happens, it will feature. It's not something that, it's a river of water that runs at 4 knots and in places, and it's bound to have a huge effect on the leg. So a lot of it's about good, accurate placement in the Gulf Stream. The Chesapeake Bay is an interesting part of the world, really. It's like a huge estuary that we go up, and it gradually gets narrow when we get towards the top. So the first part feels like you're sailing out in the open ocean. You can hardly see either side. Unless you knew you were in there, you wouldn't know you were in there. There are some tidal influences, and one of the things for me that keeps me busy is there's lots of things to hit, like buoys and the bottom is fairly shallow. So we've got to be accurate with the navigation. It's a really good leg for the navigator that wins, and not such a good leg for boats. Are always when they win, they're well sailed, and when they lose, they're badly navigated. So. There's always pressure. It's a great fleet, and everybody goes fast, and everybody sort of goes the right way in terms of, everybody's very, very smart. And, you just never know, really. You know, something will happen in this leg, and that will affect the positions. We don't know what that is yet, so we can only, go out there and sort of do the best we can, really.
One boat that certainly hopes to further benefit from this leg is Assa Abloy, and after 2 victories in the race so far, there's a lot of pressure on them to succeed in all the remaining legs.
Well, that's one of the dangers in doing well in a leg. Sponsors, family, friends, everybody else, the outside world suddenly think, hopefully you're going to win the next one as well. You know, we hope we are, but clearly it's just another yacht race. We know the dangers, the pitfalls that are there. We're going to try and do as well as we can, and we hope to get a good result. But at the end of the day, it's just another leg.
Ilbrook are still clinging on to the overall lead, and ever-reserve John Kostecki is under no illusions as to the rest of the fleet's tactics on the next leg, and isn't giving anything away about his.
They're all out to beat us, that's for sure. We have to sail our own race and do the best we can, and hopefully we can be in front or get another podium finish, and that's really mainly our goal, is to keep up in the top and let the boat and the crew do the work for us. We've done real well so far, and we just have to keep doing what we've been doing, and hopefully it'll work out for us.
On the morning of April the 14th, all the crews are up early for the race restart to Baltimore. There's all the usual last-minute bustle and confusion with crew briefings and final preparations. After a good result into Miami, Team Tyco proved they were still a team to watch and will be hoping to keep on the pace.
It's going to be all over pretty quickly. Like, we can't afford to fall off the front row, really. It's one of those races. There's not that many passing lanes or that many options, so it's going to be a very, we're going to be there in a day and a half, or halfway there in a day and a half, and then you're sort of defending for the second half, so we've got to go out blazing today, basically.
After the very close racing at the end of the previous leg, Amer Sports 2 are being taken much more seriously, especially by the fleet's male backmarkers.
A bit nervous, actually. I don't know, it feels a bit strange, this one. There's a lot of pressure on us and to perform, and we want to do really well, so I think we're putting a lot of pressure on ourselves, and a little bit of the butterflies happening. Whoever gets off the start first is going to get a good jump, get out into the Gulf Stream, and you'll be away, so starts are so important.
Gunnar Krantz on Team SEB is still reeling from a string of disastrous legs. So will this short dash be any luckier for him?
I can't comment on luck anymore. It is what it is, some very wise person said, and we just deal with reality as it comes. It's going to be three extremely hard-working days to try to get every millimeter out of this race we can. And everybody else thinks the same, so it will be intense enough for us.
Another skipper suffering from bad luck or bad form, as some critics have implied, and hoping for a better result, is Deuce Dragon's Knut Frostad, currently in sixth place overall.
It's always important for me to do well and for the team. So obviously we like to do a good one now. We're in a position where we have very little to lose and a lot to gain, which means that we will play hard from the start.
Injured Ross Field will be slightly disappointed that he's no longer sailing on Team News Corp, but he'll be there in Baltimore to welcome them in, hopefully in a good position. It's a lively send-off for the Swedes, who will be hoping for a bit more luck this time. Abloy have had a great time in Miami. Winning the previous leg has given them a chance at the overall title. And American Mike Howard expresses all the crew's thanks for a fantastic stopover. With the boats now en route to the start area, the skippers brief their crews on tactics.
Everyone's going to want the right-hand side. So we're going to try and set ourselves up, even if it means being a couple seconds late to the line. That we're on someone's line with clean air.
Everyone has a different way of preparing for this demanding leg.
It appears to be a Clark thing eating pickles.
Hey, get your own. These are all mine.
The weather on this leg is notoriously unpredictable.
Well, I have to say it's a bad dressing day first off. It's hot, rainy, then chilly. So I think we're all pretty excited to get this leg underway and just get it going.
Yeah. It's going to be good. Be fun. It's time to grunt up, work hard, get to Baltimore first. Protest! Fly up!
Everyone wants to cross the line first, but with just seconds to go and everyone jostling for position, the fast-flowing current pushes some of the boats dangerously close to the start line.
Come on, this guy.
Come down a little bit more.
We're early.
Give in, guys. Big man, big man.
Nobody's over.
Eager for a quick getaway, six of the yachts have jumped the gun.
Ship! Pull the ship on the front door!
We're over.
What?
We are over.
We are over. Six boats over.
This is Vigius. The rest of it is. Are we over already?
That's affirmative. Vigius, you have a early.
Only the girls' boat, Amer Sports 2 and Assa Abloy, got away cleanly.
Everybody but Assa Abloy and the girls were over early. Ilbrook's the only boat that's cleared themselves so far.
Run her off! Run her off! Jesus Christ! Need the boat handle, guys.
Three quarters of the fleet were now faced with a choice, either to go back and recross the line or to accept a 10-minute time penalty.
We gotta go ahead, we gotta go back.
Drop the cat, guys.
Yeah, I think we have to go back.
We gotta go back.
Yeah.
Got it! Quick! Yeah, guys, get ready to drop the shirt! You're over early!
In the event, all six boats opted to turn around and start again. Certainly not the start most of the skippers had envisaged.
Get settled here. Everybody's over except for the girls and Assa. So we're in third place. So settle down here and sail the boat.
I've never seen anything like this. How can you be too small to one?
Team last in every leg so far, we're now leading the fleet.
It's all worked out beautifully for us. There's my wife just in front of us holding us up.
No, that one's going to get replayed on the video, God knows how many times. It's unbelievable that that many boats would have been over.
It worked out pretty well for you.
Oh yeah, it was great for us, obviously. Really good for the girls. They're ahead, stretching. They're going to get the headlines today.
The rest of the pack has some catching up to do, and they'll need to be quick because this is the shortest leg so far.
Okay, here we are, 2 hours after the start. And if you pan around here, past all our boys, you'll see Ilbrook, Assa Abloy, around a little bit further, there's the girls, they've had some trouble after a good start, there's Hammer 1, that one out there's Tycho, and right up here with us is New Sport. So as you can see, it's pretty close.
We had a really good position, we got our nose out in front. So had it been a proper start, we would have won that one. Hammer 1 just under us, Digius just on top of us. And we try to hide the bow as much as we can, but it's not a retractable bow on these boats. So we we took that feature off. We would not have been over had we had the old bow on, you know, the one that was had a big hole in it.
The fleet all bunched together as day one draws to a close. Assa Abloy currently lead, but the race is wide open again, and it'll be a frantic few days with lots of place changing before the fleet arrive in Baltimore, USA. On the second day of leg six on the Volvo Ocean Race, the fleet got into the Gulf Stream and used the current of fast-flowing water to push them along. The fleet is now split into two groups. Ilbrook, Assa Abloy, Amer Sports 1 and News Corp have pulled away from the trailing pack of SEB, Tycho and Deduce Dragons. The girls on Amer Sports 2 have also slipped right back, following an unsuccessful night on a more northeasterly course. With the front runners so closely bunched, the lead is constantly changing.
Yep, knew this leg was going to be close. We're back over our shoulders here. We got Assa Abloy, News Corp, Daltz. Right now, we look like we've got a good tight battle between Daltz and News Corp. He was trying to go over the top of Dalt. Dalt's heating it up to protect his air. What so we like to see a little mini battles. Sometimes you win the battle, but you lose the war. One wrong move. Game over.
This leg was always going to be about which sails had been chosen for the conditions, and sail changes are keeping all the crews extremely busy.
A lot of sail changes, probably changing sails once an hour at the moment, trying to make the optimum of the breeze available. There's a lot of clouds and a lot of wind shifts. It's kind of like being back in the doldrums, so plenty of work for the crew.
We almost finished day two. We're around 140 miles from Cape Hatteras, around 380 miles from the finish. Pretty tight. We're in third place at the moment. News Corp just up here. Ilbrook just down there, and behind us, Assa. There's a bit of a split. These four boats, and then the rest of the fleet's back a boat, which is good for us. This is a really important leg for us, you know, really to get back up there again, get a few points on Ilbrook, on Assa, and maybe on Tycho. Hopefully catch News Corp. So we've gone okay so far. Speed seems okay. This light air, we're sailing the boat very light with hardly any sails on board, and we seem to be going hanging in there pretty well. News Corp is the quickest boat on the water though at the moment.
Roughly 3 days into leg six, and the last 4 hours have seen us probably become very top contenders for the comeback kit award of the leg.
Remarkably, fourth placed Assa Abloy had caught up with Ilbrook after being 17 miles behind.
Unbelievable. Anything can happen out here. We just need an opportunity to pounce. We'll be right back up there again.
On board Ilbrook, there's something else besides the close racing, keeping the crew occupied below deck.
What are you up to there, mate?
Oh, there's a shell, look. It's too smart. Ever since we got the Chesapeake Bay, we've been infested by bugs. Little no-see-ems, flies, mosquitoes, buzzy things, stingy bitey things. As you well know, you and I have been kipping here all afternoon. And got lots of little bites on us, so I've bloody struck back. And it's not really sport, but it's 12 love so far. I think we've just about cleared the boat, which would be good for some kip tonight.
So the flippers are working a treat for you?
It's not really fair, is it, in a little fly? I got about 110 kilo advantage and a flipper.
Just ahead of Ilbrook and Assa Abloy, there's a different battle being fought out between News Corp and Amer Sports One. News Corp lead into Chesapeake Bay, but as they headed up the river leading to Baltimore, the breeze deserted them, and Grant Dalton's Amer Sports One were able to close the gap to within three boat lengths. With virtually no breeze, both boats were almost parked up alongside each other, a tense time for both crews. Then Amer Sports One gambled by moving further offshore to shadow Assa Abloy and Ilbrook. This increases their distance to the finish line, although it gives them more breeze. Further behind, Ilbrook and Assa Abloy are now also neck and neck, fighting it out with very little wind for third place.
3 o'clock in the afternoon, around about 75 miles to go up the Chesapeake, and we've pulled in Ilbrook. Absolutely dead set flaccid out here. No wind whatsoever. And once again, Kosteki's not interested in giving any interviews.
During these uncertain times, Richard Clark's food selection comes into its own.
Yeah, the fruit loop's going, Roscoe.
What else do you do at times like these?
And at the back of the fleet, another incredible battle. Amer Sports 2 were pressuring Deduce Dragons and Tycho for sixth place. But in the end, News Corp's decision to stay inshore paid off. Although there was very little wind, she basically flapped her way through the shorter, more direct course to sneak her first victory of the race.
Singing,
last 36 hours are hell. We came into the entrance of the bay last night with a 4 mile lead, and this morning the whole fleet compressed. So yeah, I think the relief is only just setting in, and I think the elation will follow.
Amer Sports One held on to second place, although a subdued Grant Dalton probably regretted not staying with News Corp.
Congratulations to News Corp and Jez. They started a really good leg, and we were ahead of them actually twice today, and they basically took us out while we were busy watching Assa and Ulbrook too carefully. So it's getting pretty busy at the top now, but it's certainly competitive, and as I say, we're just pleased to be here and have had a good leg. The guys started really well.
So a great victory for News Corp after an intense battle with Amer Sports One. Just 3 minutes behind Assa Abloy, the overall leaders Ilbrook came in fourth, proving they are not invincible. And although for a while it seemed Amer Sports Two might finish ahead of Deduced Dragons, ultimately last place remained with the girls. The overall placings now look like this. Ilbrook still lead the fleet, but the gap is narrowing. Only 7 points separate them from Assa Abloy. The fight for overall second and third will intensify. Now three yachts are separated by just 3 points. However, for Deduced Dragons, it seems everything they do goes wrong. A poor finish is becoming a bit of a way of life for beleaguered skipper Knut Frostad. Next time on the Volvo Ocean Race, the teams will take part in a parade of sails from Baltimore to Annapolis before returning to Europe via the 3,400 nautical mile transatlantic leg to La Rochelle, France.